I got a couple of cases.
I don't need to pay.
Yeah, thank you.
Oh, that's good.
Very, very important sugya, actually. You know the joke? They said there was a fellow put up a sukkah on the property, a city property, and he got a notice that structure better go down within 8 days.
So what happened?
Did he comply?
Actually, I always thought this joke was funny until today, when it occurred to me that it wasn't that funny. I actually realized that, you know, you have San Avenue J, right? Your pizza shops. They build sukkahs on Avenue J. So, unless they have permission from the city, you're not allowed to make a broch in that sukkah.
What?
Yeah, not allowed to
it's
make
like
a broch.
It's like a stolen sukkah or something.
Yeah. So.
So the whole sukkah is invalid.
No, I didn't say that. It's complex, so we'll learn about it inside. It's not invalid, the sukkah, but you certainly cannot make the broch leisha basukkah in that sukkah. So
what's the point of being in the sukkah if you can't make a bracha?
The mitzvah. We'll see soon. Uh-huh. So
the bracha is not me'akev, right?
Yes, but if you can't make a bracha in the sukkah, it would probably be a good idea to eat in the sukkah where you could make the bracha, right?
Rabbi, isn't part of the clearance in front of the store belong to the store?
Okay.
Yes or no?
So, right. They have a legal obligation to shovel the snow.
And if they don't, they get a ticket.
Mm-hmm. But I doubt that comes to the level of ownership to the extent that they could put up a sukkah there. And why, you will see soon as we learn the Gemara and we learn the Shulchan Aruch. Why are we learning this before Yom Kippur? Firstly, there is not a lot of time between Yom Kippur and Sukkot to learn the Yoni Sukkot. But also, the Rebbe, this is a very complex sugya, and there's a Shagasai and a Menchus Chinuch, and the Rebbe has a sweet geschmack pshat that I think makes it very, very clear. But what's more is that based on the deeper understanding of what is Rosh Hashanah on Yom Kippur, come to a much deeper understanding in the halachas of lulav and sukkah. And it's remarkable to see that when you understand something better in the pnimiyus haTorah, how it sheds such a stronger light and understanding a din and niglus shebaTorah, understanding better the content of aseres yemei teshuva, Rosh Yom Kippur, helps us understand the content of lulav and sukkah and the difference between lulav and sukkah. Okay, so let's learn the Gemara. The Gemara is here in Daf Sukkah, Daf Etzchof Zayin Amud Beis. About 10 lines from the top. The first word of the line is Komash Malon. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, 11 lines from the top. Komash Malon. Tanya, Rebbe Lazar said, K'shem She'ein, Odom Yoytzei Dechavos Av Yom Tavidishin Shal Chag, B'lulo V'shal Chaveda, just like a person. When it comes, the first day of Chag, 11 lines from the top. First word is Komash Malon. Just like I can't use my friend's lulav. Diksiv, as it says in the pasuk, that you have to take the first day a fruit, a kapas tmorim. Mishalochem, it has to be yours. And we all agree in that din. And that's only the first day. The rest of the days, you don't need to have a lulav in Esek. And the Chachamim said Zecher L'Mikdash. They made it a little more lenient. But the first day, when you're obligated according to the Torah to have a lulav in Esek, the Torah says that it has to be lochem shelochem, belakachtem lochem. So Rebbe Elazar says the same thing. Kach ein odem yoytzi dechavosi b'sukkos shel chavede. I can't be yoytzi with my friend sukkah. The Ksiv, as it says in the pasuk, Chag Sukkos tase loch. Shivas Yami Mishalacha. It has to be your sukkah. That's Rabbi Lezer's opinion. That's not the halacha. Chachamim say, The first day of Sukkot, which is the Torah obligation to have a lulav, I can't use my friend's lulav. However, I can be yoitze through the sukkah of my friend. How do I know that? The ksiv, it says in the pasuk, kol ezrich bi Yisrael yeshvu besukkis. And it's like funny in this gemara. It's like it should be the way it's written in the Torah without the vavs, which seems singular. So because it's singular, it sounds like one person. So therefore, melamed, this teaches us. So that's why the hagos on the side, right? The tzorechli is besukkis without the vavs.
But melamed, the logic is if you have your love and talk of something small, so you have to have your own. But the sukkah is something big, not everybody can build.
Okay.
So automatically you will think that he be yotze.
Okay. There's a dispute if the Shin and Taima de Kro. Not everyone agrees. A big neshama, Shimon Bar Yochai, which was a big neshama, holds that the Shin and Taima de Kro. We can understand the logic of the Pasuk. You are on that level, my friend. But not everyone is on that level. I don't know. Okay. But anyway. Malamed, the Gemara says we have a post, cause in the post, it says singular. One sukkah. Why does the Torah say one sukkah? There'd be 100 sukkahs, 1,000, 1,000,000 sukkahs. Malamed, the teacher, shakol yisur and rum leisev besukkah achas. All yidden can yidden sit in one sukkah. So what do you mean? How can we all sit in one sukkah? So Rashi says, Mashma sukkah achas l'chol Yisrael sheyeshu b'zachazeh. One person will go in the next one. V'yev sheshir l'kulam d'lomoti shava pruta l'chol chad. If we all own one sukkah, that's not like, you know, there's not even one pruta that I own in that. How much does a sukkah cost? $100? How many Jews are there? It's a house of mine. El al yidei she'elu, because I'm taking it as a loan. So it must be that taking a loan works. Okay, so bottom line. Rashi has a complicated formula. Tosa has a more simpler formula how we learn it. But the bottom line is that we learn it like this. Chacham say, because it says besukoi, besukois, which is means plural, but really if you read it, besukah means one sukkah. Call the Ezra Yesha besukis in one sukkah. So what does it mean? How is one? It must be that one person owns the sukkah and he gives it alone to the other people to use the sukkah, or the whole everyone buys together a sukkah, and we all say that one per family at a time gets to sit there and we give it to them on loan. So Zechariah, that you could use a sukkah that came to you on loan. So to summarize, Chachamim hold, and that's the halacha, that both sukkah and lulav have to be my sukkah, has to be my lulav. But it's different. Lulav has to be 100% my own. It's not allowed to be not a gozel and not a shaul.
You can
can't
give it
be
can
steal
give it.
It. The minik chabad is not only to give it. The minik chabad is that we give it to say it. Yeah, the fair mole, that I'm giving it to Amatona al Manas
Lahas.
Why? Because lulav has to belong to me 100%. Not only can it be a gozel, it can't be stolen. It's not allowed to be shol. It can't be on loan. So what do we do? I give you my lulav and I tell you, you know what, Arya, this belongs to you 100%. It's a matana. In 5 minutes, you'll give it back to me.
Do
but
have
for
to,
this
do
five
I have
minutes,
to say something?
No,
when
you
I give
have
it
to
back
listen
to you.
No,
when I have
no,
to give back,
you don't have to give it back. You did your tonight. You don't have to give it. But that's the reason why.
No, when I give it back,
you
don't have to
say anything. No.
Well, then it will. Well, then it's then it's really a
because it's a condition.
A show. It's not,
it's
really
not a show. It's not a show. I made a condition. You're a man.
I'm
a man
I'm
of your word.
It to you, yeah.
Are you a man of your word or not? I gave you the bottle of seltzer. Belongs to you for 5 minutes. After 5 minutes, you return it or
oh,
not?
Oh, you give it for
you're
a
not
certain
a man
amount of time.
Yeah.
Oh, that's valid.
Right.
But that's really a loan.
That's not
no,
a loan.
No, it can give.
There's
you
two types
in other words,
of
you can sell it in those 5 minutes. It's his to get rid of.
It's his for that 5 minutes. Could he sell it or not is a separate question. But it belongs to him for that 5 minutes.
Says, I can give it on a condition.
Right.
Why is it any different than a guy buying on Pesach the chametz? In other words, instead of requiring a price for it, you're giving it. It's a transaction. Is it a different kind of transaction than the guy buying?
No guy ever bought chametz from a Jew on Pesach. Chas v'sholem.
Well, I know, before Pesach.
Before Pesach.
How is this transaction any different?
It's very different. How do you mean?
Before it just, Pesach? Just, there's no consideration.
I bought a lulav and esrog. I paid for it $150.
Yeah.
And now I came to shul. You don't have a lulav and esrog.
Right.
Or you paid $150.
But it's a
I don't
sale.
Have.
Just like chametz.
It's not a sale. It's not
sale.
A sale. It's a gift.
It's a conditional gift.
A gift.
So a conditional gift, and the other one's a conditional sale.
It's not conditional. Let's not get very. It's very. You got it all wrong with the selling of chametz. It's a sale, and there's no conditions in the sale.
It comes back. The condition is it comes back.
It does not come back. Historically, there's been goyim that didn't sell it back. It's no conditions.
Chas v'sholem. How does it get back then?
When we get to Pesach, we'll talk about. Enough complicated.
For analogy.
It's complicated enough to figure out the sukkah.
People forgot to say
I gave it to my friend, but I didn't actually say it.
It's fine if you had it in mind. That's why the minhag Chabad is to say it. Therefore, you never forget. And that's why also, in the morning, you know, if you have children in the house under Bar Bas Mitzvah, you shouldn't give it to them before you do the mitzvah, or before your spouse, or before your friends do the mitzvah. Because a child, you can't make deals with children. Children is very complicated, a kinyan with a child. A child has no das, he can't buy and sell. It's not simple to buy and sell. There's a child walking the street, I'm going to buy something from him. It's not so simple that I could buy something from a child.
Mechanech him to, for mitzvah.
Okay, so first I
you
do it.
And your spouse.
Then my wife, then my friends. And then the children. I already did the mitzvah. I don't need the lulav, so it's fine. But it's very important the first day that whoever the adults have to do it first.
But can you repeat to say the bracha?
So in other words,
he doesn't know how to say the bracha. I'm saying baruch.
With the child?
With the child.
Sure, yeah. With shem
malchut.
Sure, but that's a separate child. It's nothing to do with the lulav of agozel. Yeah, like all mitzvahs that you have to teach your children. It's a mitzvah, you're allowed to say Hashem's name. That's a separate issue. You can even say it for them because it's your obligation to give them chinuch. That's a separate shayla. Okay, again, to summarize. Lulav must be my own lulav. 100% my own. 100%. Not only am I not allowed to steal it, but I'm not allowed to have it on loan. So if I get someone's lulav, it has to be matona umanas la'achzeh. When it comes to a sukkah, and that's the halacha, if I steal the sukkah, Torah says, tasa loch, it has to be your own, not your friend's. Steal it, not yoitza. But on loan, it's kosher. It's kosher when it's on loan. Why? Because the pasuk says, sukkah singular. The way Tosfos learns it, it's a long Tosfos, but it seems in Tosfos that it's like a technical thing, you know, it's like, you know, Torah says it has to belong to me. The other, the Torah says it could be someone else's and he can give it to me. So which one is true? So you know, you have to use a little bit of seichel here. So Torah says it has to belong to me. Torah says it could take it from someone else. So if I took it from him because I stole it, not kosher. If I took it on loan, it is kosher. You got to weigh it out. That's what it seems from Tosfos.
Yeah, if you see one in shul, you can make a... You can use it.
A lulav?
Asking the...
A lulav?
Yeah.
A lulav is complicated. Very complicated. Better to ask.
But I know some shul, buy a lulav and it's...
Ah, that's different.
Leave it there.
That's different.
Everybody.
When the shul does it, it's different. Because at the beginning, it was done with the kavana. Yeah. Let's learn the halacha in the Shulchan Aruch. Turn the page. Shulchan Aruch, it's Eira Chaim, Simon, Tofer Eishlam et Zayin, the Dinim of Sukkah, Shul and Gzula. The whole Simon is on these halachas. We're just going to focus on a few halachas right now that is relevant to our discussion. Let's start from halacha 3, halacha Gimel. Halacha Gimel, turn the page. You don't have? Sorry. Here. Halacha Gimel. Toyda says Chaga Sukkah Tas Aloch, Aloch Mishaloch. That it has to be your own sukkah. Kolay Mishtea Sukkah Shaloch, it has to be your sukkah. Veloy Shal Chavercha, not your friends. Afa Pikein, nevertheless. Yoitz Odimi De Chavosa, a person fulfills his obligation, Besukkah Shula, in a sukkah that God comes to him as a loan. Kivish Nichnas Lobirishus, since he went in and he had permission, Harehi Kishaloi. It's as if he's his. This emphasis, Kishaloi, is not from the Alter Rebbe Shulchan Aruch. It's just that in the computer, you could do whatever you want, and no one's going to scream back at you.
Oh, it's a law, I see.
So I emphasize these words so you could see that the Alter Rebbe writes, it's as if it belongs to me. The Alter Rebbe doesn't bring this whole thing because it says sukkah, singular. If a person gives it to me on loan, it's as if it's mine. V'loi ne'em alach m'shaloch eloi tzatzakzula. V'aldera she'ezbor v'chein eloi tzodem dechavasa besukkah sheshlo b'shut v'simcha v'edem. V'ad partnership. Afilam nichnas l'shlibrishus chavein ezik negezol kemashal daskan nishtatu. Shkolech mehem nishtam shum kritzoyne. Also, if there is a partnership, that's part of the deal, that's considered mine. Lex alach. Afilam sukkah gzula p'amim shikshayda. Even a sukkah which is stolen, sometimes it could be kosher. Okay, it said that Eishet Tikin Yisrael Sukkosa Bo Chaveri Veitzim Sukkosa Vigozel Vyashava. My neighbor made a beautiful sukkah. I said, you know, why should I bother make my sukkah this year? I go the first night of sukkah, I drag him out of his sukkah, and go into his sukkah. Why not? Yotza, I'm Yotza the Mitzvah Sukkah. Shein Karkatin Gzelus. This is not called stealing, because karka you can never steal land. Kolayma Shein Olaya Toides Gezel Kometaltalim. It doesn't have the quote-unquote the idea of gezel. It doesn't have the din of gezel like movable stuff. Lamed b'cheskes ha-gazel b'rishus l'chodovi k'gon sh'mishbicha b'rishus gazel en ha-shevach sh'lo k'mimataltan lo'ilum b'cheskes ba'la v'reik yosh'ula b'yad gazel. It's like a loan. V'chol ha-mchuber l'karka reik ha-karka sh'nikna l'gazel l'reik yosh'ula b'yad l'fikach suker su sh'bnoi l'karka reik yosh'ula b'yad gazel b'yutz b'dechivos k'mashayetz b'suker sh'ula. It's like a suker b'sal. Never, chas v'shalom. Yeah,
that's the
never.
Scenario.
However,
repeat the scenario.
My neighbor built a beautiful sukkah. I drag him out of the sukkah, tell him you better make you an offer you can't refuse.
No,
you better not, the better not step into your sukkah for 7 days because I'm using your sukkah.
So not to use coercion?
Not allowed to. But the din is that because land cannot be stolen, there's no such thing as stealing land.
Yeah.
I could steal a bottle of seltzer because a seltzer I could put into my pocket.
Yeah.
So that's called stolen. If I take the seltzer out of Beis Menachem Mendel, I'm a ganav. But the land, I can't put land in my pocket and walk away. So according to the din of the Talmud, when if I'm a squatter, I come into your land, I'm not called a gazlan. I might be a mazik. Maybe I damaged you. I have to pay for damages maybe. But I can't be a gazlan. You can't bring me to bed and say, I'm a gazlan. I'm not a gazlan. I'm a squatter, a chosh of a squatter, but I'm not a gazlan. And you could never.
At the end of this year, I have an amazing story to tell. Go ahead.
What about the masikvul?
That's another. That's something else. It's called masikvul. Again, it's not called gazlan. It's not called gazlan.
So if you're inviting 30 people to your sukkah, so you're giving all these 30 people your sukkah.
You're giving them the sukkah, exactly. Halacha Yudalef, and this is the story of the restaurants that are making sukkahs on the public property. V'chein ein lasa sukkah. I'm skipping from Halacha Dalet to Yudalef because tonight we're not going to have enough time to learn the entire siman and Shulchan Aruch. But we're just so we'll go slower. V'chein ein lasa sukkah lechatchila b'karka sh'ravin. You shouldn't make a sukkah in public property. K'goyim rechoy v'yir in the street. K'yoytzibah mokim sh'ravin ma'ivin sham. People walk. Afilim kol ha'yir yishol Yisrael. Even if it's a Jewish city. The Jews, they presumably the Jews are moichel. The sukkahs, everyone wants that there should be pizza shop, should have a sukkah there. So the Jews are happy. The Jews, they're happy. But how about the goyim? The goyim are not happy. Why should the goyim be happy? Right. What do they care? Very sukkah gzula. Even though we said that you can't steal land, I could steal a bottle of seltzer, but I can't steal a piece of property on Avenue J. It doesn't go in my pocket.
Yeah.
So what are you telling me that there's a problem? I can't steal it. It's not called stolen.
Right.
That's not the way to do the mitzvah. Why? It's not mamish, my sukkah. Torah said, you make yourself a sukkah. Mishaloch. You make, the Torah said, make yourself a sukkah. Ah, you're going to say, but alone? If I took a sukkah alone, it's kosher. So what's the difference? When the owner gives it to me and his goodwill.
Right.
Again, I emphasize these words, but I'm just emphasizing to bring your attention. If the owner gave it to me, then it becomes mine. Mamish, it becomes mine. But if he didn't give it to me, It's a technical thing that land cannot be stolen. I could put a seltzer in my pocket. I cannot put Avenue J in my pocket. So if I go and I build myself a little hut in Avenue J, I can't, never mind the mortgage. It's too expensive. I go buy, build myself, I go and I buy a tent and I pitch it in Avenue J. So people might not like me, but I'm not called a gosler. You can call me a squatter. Can't call me a gosler. So if I'm not a gosler, what's wrong? The answer is it's still not shaloi. I didn't steal the property, but it's not my property. I can't come and say it just because I had a tent and I slept there for 3 nights in Avenue J, a chazaka, 3 nights. You can't say, oh, now Avenue J belongs to me. So true, I'm not a ganef. I'm not a gazlan, but I can't say that belongs to me.
Right.
And the Torah says chag that the sukkah should be tasaloch. You make a sukkah. If it's a loan, it's as if it belongs to me.
So how come restaurants that build up outside the sukkah and the curtain for 7 days? Because the law said they will come to give you a fine if you have it for 10 days. So after 7 days, they take it off. They come in to check. First, they say, then they know it's 10 days and it's off. Are you allowed to do that? To see on the sukkah?
Not allowed to. However, because karka ain't an exelis, karka is not a bottle of seltzer.
Okay.
If I went into that sukkah, I did the mitzvah of sukkah. But they're not allowed to do it. And, v'lekach, yesh limchus. You're supposed to protest. Be'oisim sukkah, b'rishus
rabim. It's a business. You're losing business. You have so many days yom tov.
I'll tell you, there's an eitzah. There's an eitzah.
What is he asking?
Yes.
I didn't catch what he's asking.
Yes.
Well, what was his question?
And he's saying, what do you mean? What should people do? Yeah. The restaurant owners need to build a sukkah.
Yeah. Build outside.
Yes.
But according to the law in New York,
right,
you're allowed to build outside for 10 days. If after 10 days still there, you get fine. So after 7 days, you take it off. So they.
It's not a problem.
So what's the problem?
But according to the, you're not to build it. It's a goyim. It's a car that's not yours. Why build it?
I mean, even if the law is, you have to, they permit it, you're saying?
They're not permitted.
In Manhattan, Lloyd restaurants have a little cafe outside, and the city.
No, this you have to get permission.
You get permission.
100%.
Get permission.
I was on 34th Amendment. This we have to get permission to put tables and chairs.
If they're telling you they're not going to fine you after 10 days,
they have to get permission.
That's the law. That's the law. 10 days.
Well, that's permission. That's implied permission.
That's not implied permission.
Yeah, you know that. If sukkah was 15 days, you would not put it. Because sukkah 7 days, and you have 2 days and 2 days.
Oh, so you're saying because the law doesn't revolve around the holidays specifically, then it's not permitted.
You don't have a kosher deluxe on the corner here? You stay the big sukkah, putting there maybe 30, 40 people.
I told you there's an eitzah.
I think you can make it on.
The eitzah is to get permission. Now, the question is who to ask permission from. So that's the issue. Now, you know,
if
you're going
to... It
belongs to the city. Oh, it belongs to the city. So... Here is where we could. We have to think about this.
I mean,
the truth is, it does belong to the city. The question
so
is.
So you're cheating the city.
Right.
You know, after 10 days, they will come to see if it's still there. It's not there. You don't get
far. But the fact they give you 10 days has to do with sukkahs.
The fact you do it all the
leeway,
time.
That leeway. Has to do, how do you know it doesn't have to do with sukkahs?
I checked it out.
Okay, so it could be.
Well, can I say, sometimes Pesach, you see a lot of groceries, they get a little van, big van. This is, you have to get permission for it. You know, Frigidaire van, they put outside for a week or so. You get permission. You need to pay money for that. Because this is basic. But if you build up tent, you can take it off right away. You build sukkah, they come in, you take off the thing.
So why
did
they give you 10 days? What's the reason for the 10 days?
I have no idea.
Let's continue the legal discussions after the year. Even the practical discussions, I think, we'll leave for after the year. There might be a way to ask permission. And the question is who to ask permission from. You might not need the mayor himself to sign off on the permission.
The housing, somebody from the housing.
The permanent caretaker.
But you need to get permission. V'lekach says the Alter Rebbe, yeshlim chaz ba'isim sukkah b'rishus rabim, that they should protest to those that build a sukkah without permission in the rishus rabim. V'chol mokim shebi'arun shein latzal shein sukkah lechatchila. Since we said that in these places you're not allowed to make a sukkah to begin with, Over the also, if a person did make a sukkah, even though technically it's kosher, and if you eat in it, it's considered eating in a sukkah. You shouldn't make a brocher. Because this mitzvah came to him through an aveda.
What's his name, the rabbi in
Jersey?
Huh? What's his name? Kanelsky. Kanelsky. He has a group. They go to every place in Jersey, like the Hanukkah, and they ask permission, and they're inviting the mayor of the town to come to the sukkah, and they make celebration. Ah. Like the Hanukkah. They have like 30 of them.
Right.
I have a question. I thought you could...
Chabad also, Midtown, Chabad. They get permission. But they get permission to build a sukkah.
From the city.
They get permission from the city. Right. Right.
I thought you could only get credit for a mitzvah, that you did make a bracha on b'di'evit, not l'chatchila. You're saying this is l'chatchila, that you're going in there knowing you're not making a bracha. So how are you chapping the mitzvah l'chatchila without a bracha?
A bracha doesn't, if you put on telling you didn't make a bracha, you still do the mitzvah. You still do the mitzvah.
Even l'chatchil, but why wouldn't you put a, why wouldn't you make a bracha on tefillin?
Because if a person steals the tefillin, so then he can't make a bracha on it. He could, he did the mitzvah, but he can't make a bracha on it.
So you're saying it's better to steal tefillin and go a day without using tefillin, don't you get the mitzvah?
I didn't say that. That's another complicated issue. I'm just trying to stick to the sukkah.
Maybe a lot of missing tefillin at 770 if you go that way.
No. The thing is, tefillin is
on video.
The Gemara says that the person is assumed that Nechilel Linish Lovid Mitzvah B'mamoino B'dov Hashem B'chisoron Kis. Yeah, you assume that people will be very happy that people would do a mitzvah if they're not going to lose anything. Because if you're going to take a person's tefillin, you put it back in place and wrap it up the way that person, to the best of your ability, the way that person wrapped it up, and the same thing when it comes to using Sfarim these days, according to the Aruch HaShulchan. The Aruch HaShulchan holds that the same thing applies to books today. Books are not that expensive to buy, so people would be happy to know that another Jew had used their Gemara, and provided that you put it back in its place, and if there's bookmarks,
so it's not stealing. What about Ein Bar Mitzvah Bavera?
I will not answer.
Ein Bar Mitzvah Bavera.
I have to continue. After this year, we need to cover something here. So it's important questions. You don't hold on to it. Don't.
It's another first.
So the thing is like this: if you look at the words of the Alter Rebbe. The Alter Rebbe says that this is called Shaloi Mamish. When someone gives me a loan of a sukkah, it belongs Mamish to me. Frek the Rebbe, a simple question. So why shouldn't you say something by a lulav? Why by a lulav you say no? A loan is not considered as if it's, if you give it to me as a loan, I'm not yoytze to the mitzvah. You have to give it to me as a matona. You have to give it to me, it belongs to me, as a gift.
Isn't there a connection to the lulav and esrog, to the person's neshama?
Sure there is.
When they're making the tefillah.
Sure there
so
is.
So don't they have to own it in order to get that?
So, but why is it by a sukkah? Sukkah also has a neshama. Oh, sure, sukkah has even do more with the neshama. It's makif and the bina. No. So why is it that by the sukkah, if you tell me it's a technical thing, it's a cause of the Eibusha said, But if you're going to tell me, like the Alter Rebbe says, that when a person gives me a sukkah and loan, it becomes my sukkah. So why is it that we don't say the same thing by a lulav? If a person gives me a lulav, it becomes my lulav.
Is that a katuf, right? Like you said.
If you would say it's exeted, it would be very nice, but that's not what the Alter Rebbe says. If the Alter Rebbe would bring the posuk, that sukkah is singular, he doesn't. He just says, he adds a few words here. He says, Areyuk Shaloi Mamish. And he says that by a sukkah, when I get it on loan, the kivin shenich muslab rishus, I have a mission. Underline. That's why I underline those words. Harei kishaloi, it becomes mine. That's not what that's not in the clear in the words in the Gemara. Now Alter Rebbe is explaining that's the pshat. That the pshat is that it became mine. That now it's my sukkah. You gave it to me alone. It's mine. So why is it that by a lulav, if you give it to me as a loan, no kosher, it doesn't become my lulav. And why is it that you give me a loan? Your sukkah, it does become my sukkah. Why is it different? Why is it different? So, the Rebbe's answer is like this. By the way, this Alter Rebbe, there's poskim that learned the pshat this way in Rashi, and I mean, there's many, there's Rishonim that learned this way, but what is, how does it make sense? So the Rebbe's answer is like this. What does it mean when you give me a sukkah? Torah says that you have to live in a sukkah. It has to be your house, right? It has to be a deres keva. So a person, if you're giving me a house and it doesn't become my house, that's not a house. How is that a deres keva? If I need a place to live, and you say I can live in your house, that's very nice. I live in your house for a couple of days, but that's not. That doesn't become my house, right? Yeah. The Chazal say, "Kol mishein lebayis ein odom." A person doesn't have a house; is not a person. Okay, so maybe I buy the house, or there's a certain ownership which is schidus. I rent. It means it's my house. It's a certain bailus. If I rent, this is. So say a person has a place to live, but it's not a rental. It's not an ownership. They're oirach. They're a guest. You know, like the story of the Maggid.
What can I say? I'm giving this
You could do everything. You could do it by a lulav also. If you say it's matona manas lahachzer, it's a matona. But if you didn't say it and you just said you could come to my house if you were here, you stay here for a couple of days. So how does a person feel when he's living in your house? Not his house. You know the story of the Maggid. That the Maggid had a friend that years later came to her, the goddess of the Maggid, and he came to visit the Maggid. He saw the Maggid was living in such poverty, so he cried. He said, how do you live in such poverty? You have nothing in your house, no furniture, a broken table, a couple of boxes instead of chairs, there's straw on the floor. I mean, how can you live this way? So the Maggid turned to the man and said, and you, I don't see, where's your furniture? I don't see your, I see you just go walking with a suitcase. Where is that? I have more than you. I got a table, I got a couple of broken chairs. He said to Rebbe, what are you talking about? At home I have a beautiful house and furniture. Here, I'm just traveling. Under vegans. I'm just traveling. I'm on the road. Maggid said, you're right. That's me, the same thing. I'm just on the road. We're just under vegans. Mm-hmm. Just on the road. So temporary. But it's a different feeling when you're temporary than you're permanent. Mm-hmm. So there's a permanent residence. A person has a house. He feels like a man. It's a rental, it's ownership, but it's my daladamas. This is my place, this is my space. So sukkah, the Torah says, it's to be teshvukein teduru. It has to be my space. So now, if you give me a loan, a sukkah, the Eibusha said that I have to have a sukkah, and a sukkah means teshvukein teduru, probably you're giving me, that's what you're giving me. You're giving me now a house. Because the Eibishta required that I should have a sukkah, and the sukkah should be teishuot kein taduru, so that's what probably you're giving me. But when it's coming to a lulav is a thing that I have to take in my hand. So the Torah says that it has to belong to me, but why should I assume, if you gave it to me, that you meant that it should belong to me completely? If you say so, you say, I'm giving it to you, here, chayim ber, I'm giving it to you, matona manas lahachzer, okay, then you said it. But if you didn't say it, you didn't say it. So it's a loan. And a loan, it doesn't belong to me. It belongs to you. But when it comes to a sukkah, that's what the Torah is mechadish. The Torah is saying a sukkah is different than a lulav. A sukkah means that it's my house. A house, if it's not, it doesn't belong to me, it's not a house. So that's what the Torah is mechadish. The Torah is telling us that when it comes to a sukkah, when it's a loan, we assume that the person that gave it with his full thing, with his full heart. You need a house? Here, my sukkah will be your house. What does it mean it's your house? It means it belongs to you, mamish. Shaloi mamish, you need a house. You need a lulav? Okay, that's something else. You need a sefer? A sefer does not. But if you need a house, a sukkah means you need a house. For 7 days, you need a house. And you come to me, you say, please can you give me a loan? I'm giving you a house. So I'm giving it to you as a house. It should become yours. Mashainkin, if I give you a lulav, okay, the Abisha says, yours. I'm giving you a lulav. But if I didn't say it belongs to you, it doesn't belong to you, it belongs to me. Therefore, by a lulav, I have to say, I'm giving it to you as a matona. But when it comes to a sukkah, that's what the Torah is saying. I don't have to say that. To understand this on a deeper level, there is when it comes to the three main chagim, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and Sukkot, There's three parts in every Yom Tov of this, of Rosh Hashanah, and there's three parts in Yom Kippur and in Sukkot. Every Yom Tov has mitzvah sayoyim. What's mitzvah sayoyim of Rosh Hashanah? What's a special mitzvah?
Shofar.
Mm-hmm. The karbonis is the same thing. Issur malach is the same thing. Safas mechayla lakodesh. The karbonis is slightly different, but still they're karbonis. What is mitzvah sayoyim? Shofar. When you're talking about Yom Kippur, what's mitzvah sayoyim on Yom Kippur? Tshuva, fasting, vidui. That's a mitzvah sayoyim. When it comes to Chag HaSukkos, what's mitzvah sayoyim?
Minyan
Sukkah. Then, when we talk about Rosh Hashanah, and let's focus on Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur, it's Aseres Yemei Tshuva. It's Aseres Yemei Tshuva, right? We say Aseres Yemei Tshuva means 10 days. That means Rosh Hashanah, day one, day two, the 10th day is Yom Kippur. All 10, it's not Shivas Yemei Tshuva. It's Aseres Yemei Tshuva. It's 10, so these 10 days are days of Tshuva. So there is something, a mitzvah in Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur. There is that Rosh Yom Kippur is days of Tshuva. And then there's something specific to Rosh Hashanah. What's special about Rosh Hashanah? That Chazal say, the Eibishter says, Tamlichuni Aleichem, make me your king. And what's unique about Yom Kippur and the day? The Gemara says, Itzumei shel yoim mechaper. The day itself is mechaper. Now, Chachamim say that in order to get that kapara, you need to do tshuva first. Good, but still, Chachamim don't say that there's no such thing as Itzumei shel yoim. There is a concept of Itzumei shel yoim, but you have to also do tshuva. But there is a thing of Rosh Hashanah is Tamlichuni Aleichem. The day the Eibishter says it, Saad Yagod says, 10 reasons why we blow shofar. Top reason is, that's the day we make the Eibishter king. Lower in the list is also tshuva, like the Rambam says. Remez yesh, but there's a remez in the shofar. Uri Yosheinu Mishinas. It's a remez. It's not, the first the three things we have here. The mitzvah of the day, in Rosh Hashanah, shofar, in Yom Kippur, it's the fasting and the vidui. There is the days of tshuva, and there is the Indian of the day. Rosh Hashanah is the main day, Mishter King. Yom Kippur, it's Tzumah Shel Yom. If you think about it, these are three levels, says the Rebbe, of the connection of a Jew and a Eibishter. On the lowest level, there is two things. There is the Rebbeinu Shlalom, and there's the Jew. Two separate things. In order to connect, it's a mitzvah. Mitzvah is tafza. We connect. How do we connect the Eibishter and the Jew? Through a mitzvah, 613 mitzvahs connect us in 613 ways. Then there's a deeper thing. He sinned. He didn't do any mitzvahs. Why are you crying? Go out, do another sin. What are you coming here to shul, crying? Every year the Zaysim Yitzhuva is feeling uncomfortable. Why are you so restless? Go do another 10 Avedas. What? No, because the year is uncomfortable. Why? Because there's a connection that's very deep between the neshama and the Eibishter, regardless if he did the mitzvahs or didn't. He never did one mitzvah, and he did all the avedas. But when he does tshuva, you see that there's something so deep connected, even if he didn't do the mitzvahs, he's still connected. And then you have even a deeper connection that you see. Chazal say, the Eibishter says, Tamlichuni Aleichem, make me a king. In other words, it sounds like if the Jews will not accept him as a king, he won't be their king. So why are you asking him to be your king? So don't ask him to be your king. I mean, it's not so simple. But just on that level, Chazal say, Tad Eibishter is asking, Imru lefanash am lechuni. It's like so why? Because the Yidden, they can't be without the Eibishter. They can't live without it. They can't live without it. So. These are three levels in how deep the Yidden are connected with the Eibishter. So if you remember, we learned the Maimer of Atam Netzavim, and right before Rosh Hashanah. The Alter Rebbe says, when the Yidden make the Eibishter a king, Hayoim, Atam Netzavim, Hayoim is going on Rosh Hashanah, Kulchem, all Yidden, Mersheichem, Shifteichem, Choyte, Veitzach, Hashem, all Jews are equal. Why? Because when the essence of the Neshama is revealed, Moshe Rabbeinu and the simplest Jew is the same thing. They count one for a minion, 10 people, they're the same thing. When it comes about making the Eibishter a king, That is the revelation of the neshamas. All yidin are mamish one. Then, if you're talking in the level of tshuva, tshuva also, a rasha gomer in one moment can become a tzadik gomer, but it takes one moment. They're not the same. Before the moment and after the moment, it takes one moment. And then there is mitzvahs. In mitzvahs, there's many levels. You can't say there's big tzaddikim, there's regular tzaddikim, there's beinanim, there's rishayim, there's big rishayim aleim charotas. There's many levels of tzaddikim. In mitzvahs, you can't. No two Jews are the same. If you want to break it down in a more in the whole chagim of the so Rosh Hashanah, the main emphasis on Rosh Hashanah, at least in Chassidus, is that we make the Eibishter king. Yom Kippur, the main emphasis is the atonement of sin, which is connected with tshuva. Chag HaSukkos is all the mitzvahs. That's when we do all the mitzvahs at the third level. But in a miniature way, in Rosh Hashanah there's three things, Yom Kippur there's three things, and in Sukkah there's three things. And if you look closely at Sukkos, why the Alter Rebbe says that the first half and the second half of the month are a reflection of the same thing. Bakesa liyum chagenu. The Gemara says kesa means chag shag shemiskasa boi Rosh Hashanah, and the chagenu stam chag is Sukkos. Whatever is hidden the first 15 days of the month is revealed in the next 15 days of the month. So it's the same thing. So whatever, there's three levels in Rosh Hashanah, there's three levels in Sukkos.
Also Bakesa, you're anointing Hashem as a king. He's sitting on the kiseh.
So also in Sukkos, yeah, you have the exact same thing.
This is
chassidus,
right?
That the first level in Sukkos is the Torah. We spoke about this once. The Torah, in the minig is that people call Pesach Pesach, and Sukkos they call Chag HaSukkos. Why is it called Chag HaSukkos? There's a lot of things we do on Sukkos. We do Netilas Dalad Minim, the Simchas Beis HaShevin, the Zman Beis HaMikdash, the Suchamayim. But when you come, because if you look at the Psukim, it says Basukas Teishvu Shivas Yomim. It doesn't say that there is a Chag, that Shivas Yomim, and then you should build a Sukkah. Because if you think about it for a moment, in Pesach, the Eibusha took the Yidden out of Egypt. So it's a special time. Because of that, we eat matzah, and we eat more, and we drink three kais of wine, and four kais of wine, and we say da goda, and lo yiro lo chomitz. We do a lot of things. What happened on the 15th day of Tishrei? Nothing happened. Mm-hmm. Nothing happened. The Eibusha said, I want the Yidden to build Sukkahs. And then, once it's a, they build the Sukkah, there's a certain chalois, there's a kedusha that comes into the world. And then the Torah says, Lekachtem lechem b'yoyim harishon. After you build a sukkah, then you're going to, b'yoyim harishon of that sukkah you built, you're going to take a lulav and an esrog, and an adasim and an arava. So the number one is, there's the sukkah. The sukkah makes the yom tif. Then there is a specific mitzvah that we do, which is the dalad minim. Then there is Misamachtim Lifnei Hashem Alakechem Shivas Yomim, which has to do with this incredible amount of Simcha. The Anshe Knesset Agdoila said that we should say that Zman Simchaseinu. The Medrash says over here it says three times Simcha Nisachamayim had to do with Simcha. There's a strong connection to Simcha over here. So the Sukkah expresses, we said that Rosh Hashanah is later by Kesa, is hidden, and Yom Chagenu reveals what's hidden in Sukkahs. So the Tamlichuni Aleichem, the fact that the Yidden make the Eibishter king, where is that expressed? That's expressed in the Sukkah. Because when the Eibishter is made a king, that's where you see that the Eibishter and Yidden are one, and all the Yidden with each other are one. Rasheichem, Shifteichem, Chshev, Hitzachachem, because the Etzem and the Shama, all Yidden are the same thing. So therefore, the Torah says, Chag HaSukkos Tasaloch, Sukkos is Loshen Yochid. Malamet Shekol Yisroel Ruim Leisha B'Sukkah Achas. All Yidden sitting in exactly the same Sukkah. Because this is a revelation of which part of the Neshama? The essence of the Neshama. That's one with Hashem Yisborah, and therefore one with every other Yid. Similar to what the Yerushalmi says. The Yerushalmi says that if a person, Rahman Latzlan, would hit his hand accidentally at a hammer and hit, he was hitting, you know, he was building the Sukkah. But he's like a Yid, you know, me and you, we're not builders. You know, like the Jackie you Mason talks about the screwdriver,
the best
right?
Builders in the world, by the way.
That's true. But it comes to Sukkah, every Yid has to build. Also the non-builders. It's a mistake. You took a knock and you hurt one hand. is that the Yerushalmi says, have a mekata kupa de machmasakin el yude tachzev timche li yode. He gave it with a hammer, with an axe, and achmon leslan. He hurt the finger from the left hand, hurt the right hand. The right hand is not going to take revenge. That's not shayach such a thing. It would be a nutcase. So when the etzim and the sham is revealed, how we make the Eibishter a king, so then all the Yidden are one. So that's revealed in the mitzvah sukkahs. Kol yisor ruim leisha besukkah achas. All Yidden are equal to sitting in the same sukkah. Then there is a second level of achdus, a lower level of achdus. The Chmedr says that the goyim and the Yidden go in front of the judge. We don't know manu tzchaya, who wins. When the Yidden walk out with the lulav and esrig, anan yaden dida notzach. We know that the Jews won, like the person that came out of court and he's waving the thing in his hand. We know that the judge must have signed off in his favor. Why is he smiling and waving the paper? Because he won. So when the Yidden come out and they're waving the lulav and the esrig, so is an ayah that the Jews won. So this is an expression of the tshuva of Aseres Yimei Tshuva, which is with the Yidden the tshuva. So there was oichah b'din. So now they are they're waving the lulav and esrig. Here the achdus is not as strong. Here it's 4 minim. Chazal say there's a lulav Jew, there's an esrig, there's a Jew that smells good and tastes good. The Jew just tastes good, it just smells good. So they're not one. You're saying that there's different properties. He smells and tastes good. He just smells good. He just tastes good. He doesn't smell good anything. Still will bring them together. It's not the same achdus as kol yisrael ruim leisha besukkah achas. Kol yisrael ruim leisha besukkah achas means it's one sukkah. They're all the same. They're mamish equal. There is no difference between one yid and the other yid. When you're talking about in the achdus of the dalad minim, we're saying that specifically there are four types of yid. Mm. There are four yid. They're not exactly the same. Still, we bring them together by achdus. That expresses the second level of Rosh Hashanah, which is tshuva. Over there's a revelation of the neshama, a very deep revelation, but still, there is a person that does tshuva quicker, and then some people take some a little longer to kricharein. So therefore, there is a difference in one Jew and the other Jew. So there is a lulav Jew and Esther Jew. It's just that we all come together. We all come together by achdus. And then, so again, in Rosh Hashanah, there is this achdus that's shown through tshuva, and now we see it through the lulav and esrog coming together. Yeah, and one second, the lowest level is the level of simchas beis hasheiva. Simchas beis hasheiva, not everyone could dance. Chazal say that the chassidim anshei ma'aseh, they were dancing, and kol ha'om anoshim anoshim kulam boim lirus lishmoya. Only the tzaddikim could dance. Okay. Mm-hmm. So we see, even though there was an achdus that everyone came to the Beis HaMikdash, but not everyone is dancing. Yeah. Only the chassidim ve'anshei ma'aseh are dancing. And the rest of the people are watching and they are not dancing. So this is really the Rambam says that the when he talks about the Shafta Mai Mesosin, Simcha Beis HaSheva, he says that all the mitzvahs that a person has to have, Simcha Shal Mitzvah. And it's critical that a person should have Simcha Shal Mitzvah. And the Rambam is not talking about one mitzvah, he's talking about all 613 mitzvahs. But he talks about it in the context of Simcha Beis HaSheva. So Chassidus says, why did the Rambam say that? Because the gate to feel Simcha Shal Mitzvah of all 613 mitzvahs is in the Simcha of Sukkahs, helps us feel the Simcha of all 600. That's what's important so much, to dance on Simchas Beis HaSheva, because that helps us feel the Simcha in all 613 mitzvahs. But because it's a Simcha of mitzvah, true, it shows our unity with Hashem Yisborach, and therefore it shows our unity with other Jews, because once we're one with Hashem Yisborach, we see how we're really one with other Jews. But over here, the unity is less. Therefore, the tzaddikim dance, and the other people are only watching.
Sorry. But you can say, Shomei ka kore, ro'e ka roked. Same thing.
But who decides who dances?
No, I got.
Who decides who dances and who doesn't, then?
That I don't know. But that was it.
But isn't it kind of an idiot from Gaiva? I can dance, you can't? So
I don't know. I don't know exactly. I guess the people that were coming to the Beis HaMikdash in the presence of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, there was no such thing as fake gaiva or fake fanfare.
You knew who you were.
You knew who you were. So if you felt like dancing, you danced. And if you knew you weren't fit for dancing, you stood there and you watched.
Rabbi, remember last year I said a story, I like to repeat it. I had one time in the sukkah, my sukkah, I had a friend from the army that was a little religious. I didn't see him maybe for 20 years, and I saw him in America. Not religious, just 3 kids, and doesn't know nothing for me. So I said, you know, next week, Sukkot, I'd like you to come for dinner in my sukkah. He said, no, I can't. You know, I said, come make a bracha. No, I can't. Then he called me, he said, you know why I can't? Because they have a game that night on TV, I don't know, Yankees, I don't know, Giants. So I said, so? He said, yeah, but I want to watch the game. I said, I bring your TV to the sukkah. What's the big deal? I bought him TV. He benched 11 o'clock. He washed hamotzi and everything. And he watched the TV. And I took it from my neighbor, and I gave it back to him. That's it. That's what I did. Remember that beautiful, you know?
Wow, that's good.
No excuse. You don't want to say the sukkah? I got you. What's the big deal?
Wow.
I think it's the first time since, who knows, he sat in the sukkah. Yeah.
Are you allowed to bring a TV in?
No,
I don't know if you're allowed to. But because of that, he make a bracha, he washed him tirat adayim, he made a tirat lulav, his two boys make bracha and lulav, put kippah under the
roof.
For 10 minutes, 20 minutes, whatever it is.
100%. You should start your own Chabad house.
I don't have TV.
1970.
He already had the
Chabad in France. So they started a thing in the yeshiva that in the summer they would open it up for not only yeshiva students, for people that would come. And that was a big Bala Tshuva movement in France, and there was a lot of people that would come
to yeshiva.
The Rabbi Yazimov, those thousands that came over the years later to 770. There was a fellow he said he was sent there by the yeshiva in Aix-les-Bains. So in France, in Aix-les-Bains, there's a Litvish yeshiva. Why would they send a Chabad, a student? And he said he was married Nebach Tvashiksa. And he once they stopped him in the street, they put on film with him. So he started thinking, what's this film? And he had a lot of questions. He ended up in the yeshiva in Aix-les-Bains. And he realized that he's a Yid. He divorced his Shiksa. She had a wife, 4 children. He was an architect. He left everything behind. Checked into yeshiva. But he had questions, you know, questions on Amunah. And he was looking for something deeper. So the Rosh Yeshiva in Aix-les-Bains said, you know what? You graduated our yeshiva. Go to Bromois. That's a suburb of Paris. That's where the Lubavitch yeshiva is. Went in yeshiva over the summer. Came Tishrei. Everyone's going to the Rebbe. Traveled with everyone to the Rebbe. After the Chagim, back those days, there were still yechidas. The Rebbe had to have yechidas, especially the guests that would come from far. When you went for yechidas, he would write a note with questions, mm-hmm. And the Rebbe would, zoichet to have yechidas, the only person in the base when to have yechidas. Wow. So the Rebbe looked at his thing, he had 22 questions. And the Rebbe answered all his questions. But so, remarkable, 2 questions and 2 answers that he had. One of the questions he had, he said, if I want to be a Chabad Chosid, I see that in all the Chabad houses, there's a picture of Lubavitcher Rebbe. Do I have to also have a picture of Lubavitcher Rebbe? He says, very big picture in every Chabad house. The Rebbe said, you don't have to have a big picture, you have a small picture. And if you don't like it, you don't have to picture at all. So then he said, his other question was,
that's cute.
that he thinks he was in yeshiva in Bonnois, and he was in the Chabad house in Paris. He says he thinks that the Lubavitch and that their love to admiration of the Rebbe is somewhat exaggerated. What does the Rebbe think about that? So the Rebbe said he doesn't think it's that terrible. He says my love to Yidden is so intense that it must be just a bounce back. It's just natural. Leva odam ala odam. So I don't see anything wrong with that. Wow. Next question is interesting to hear how the Rebbe thought what he thought. He thought, because I love Yidden so much and they love me back. It's a circle. What's the big pella? We love each other. We're Yidden. Then, and the other question was, he says, Rebbe, how do you know how to answer? Thousands of people come ask you questions. How do you know what the right answer is? The Rebbe said, you know, when a person has a problem, a difficult issue in life, a normal person would consult. Always make your own, you consult. Who do you consult with? Friends, people who know your situation, people who know you. and are older, wiser, and they'll give you advice. I feel for every yid so much that when a yid comes and tells me their problems, I really feel it. I feel it. So I know what they're going through, and I feel it, so I know what to tell the person. So then at Fabrengen, the Rebbe gave him a bottle of vodka, and he said that when he goes back to yeshiva, he should give out from the vodka, and he should share his conversation with the Rebbe. So I just think, you know, this is like remarkable. The Rebbe didn't see, and it's like a psagadlus. You know what I mean? I love Yidden so much that I feel them. I feel what they're feeling. So I'm like a good friend. What do you mean? You ask, so how does, I know you for 10 years, we know each other, and you have an issue. So you ask me advice, or I ask you advice. Well, what's the big deal? So we know, because we love each other. So this is really when in the Avas Yisrael there is three levels, and also in the Av of Yidden Takadosh Baruch there's three levels. There is the Rosh Hashanah, there is the Yom Kippur, and there's Sukkot. There is Tamlichuni Aleichem, there's Tshuva, and then there's Mitzvahs. And within Sukkah there is Sukkah, which is Kol Yisrael is Mesukkah Achaz. The Yidden and the Eibishter are one, and therefore one Yid with the other Yid is Mamish one. So therefore, if I ask you alone to give me your sukkah, and you give me your sukkah, this is now my sukkah. If I steal the sukkah, no, then it's not mine. Because then I showed, it's like you're saying, if all the Eden I want, so why am I gone? If I take the bottle of seltzer from you, but mine, dine va mine. If it's yours, it's mine. And we're one, so how am I gone? So obviously, that's a silly question. It's like when we were in students, yeshiva, they'd say, "Akorket kavochomer." The ganav said, "Kavochomer." Madach, you're not allowed to put your hand in my pocket, but I'm allowed to put my hand in my pocket. Is kolchken in your pocket? Well, you could put your hand in your pocket. Kolchken, I could put my hand in your pocket. So the kavochomer, the ganav. It's wrong, because if me and you are one, so why am I taking it from you? When it's in your pocket, good. Your pocket is my pocket. So why am I taking it out of your pocket? In the charaya, that your pocket is not my pocket.
You don't have
that's a ganav. That's a ganav. So if a person steals his friend's sukkah, is that there's no achtus. But when there is achtus, I'm saying, Rafal, can I please step into your sukkah? And you say, yes. Now we're one. So your sukkah is my sukkah is your sukkah.
You say steal, you mean he steps in without permission.
Or let's say steal.
Let's say he goes in without permission.
But let's say, what happens in the Dalad Minim? So I ask you if I can use your Dalad Minim. What is the Achdus of Dalad Minim? That's where the Yidden, that reveals the Tshuva. That the Yidden, the Tshuva, now they won the Din through Tshuva. So now the Achdus between the Eibishter and Yidden is revealed, and between one Yidden and the other Yidden. But as separate things, as a Lulav Jew, as an Esek Jew, as a Rava, as a Adasim Jew. Therefore, if I ask you to give it to me, you have to specifically say it's Maton El Manas L'Achzer. That you give, because if you don't, I say, it's nice, you gave it to me as a loan, but it doesn't belong to me. Yours is, you're an Esek Jew, but I'm a Rava Jew. So now you have to, if you gave it to me, we don't assume that it belongs to me. You have to say it's a matonas manas
la'achzer. How come only Chabad say that? Other people don't say that.
Everyone. It's just that Chabad say it. They say it. And therefore, but then there's even a lower level, which is where the Yidden and the Eibishter are two. And they have to connect them through a mitzvah. And same thing, one Yidden and another Yid are separate. But they respect each other. I mean, they know that each one contributes to Klal Yisrael. And over there, that's expressed in mitzvahs, and that's specifically expressed in the Simcha Shel Mitzvah, that over there, there's the tzaddikim that dance, and then the spectators that they watch.
So the sukkah is one mitzvah again? What's this?
We have three things we said in sukkah. There's the sukkah, there's the lulav and esrog, and then there's the Simcha's Beis HaSheva.
And the sukkah is
the sukkah is all Yidden are one.
All Yidden are one.
And the lulav, we get together, but as four different groups. And then there's the simcha, simcha shel mitzvah, that we get together, but some are dancing.
Question, what if you walk into a sukkah without permission? People have sukkahs. You walk in, is that stealing?
That we say, that's similar to wearing a person's tefillin on a one-time basis. Because we say that probably we assume that if he's not there, you didn't grab him out of a sukkah. You walked into a sukkah.
We assume. Let's say he...
If you made it clear you shouldn't come in, then we don't assume.
Is he allowed to forbid you to come in?
Sure, he's allowed to.
What?
Sure, he's allowed to.
Oh, you are allowed to. So, but that's a contradiction. To assume, if he's not there, that yes, but then he's still allowed.
Why is that a contradiction? Most Jews, we say.
Because most Jews are.
Well, they'll be happy. They're not in the sukkah, but I could put. Okay. If for whatever reason I have a problem with people, I could put a sign on my sukkah.
So it's a mitzvah to give a lulav and esrog. A person doesn't have it.
Sure, big mitzvah. Which is even a bigger mitzvah to look for those Jews that don't have yet. Like Sasson found the yid that didn't get on this. And then bring him into the sukkah and bring him and give him a lulav and esrog. The Eibusher should help.
I'm looking for
that. This Chag HaSukkos should be not the last Sukkos in Golus. It should be the first Chag HaSukkos in the Gula Amitas Vashlema that we should celebrate it in Yerushalayim Yir HaKodesh.
Amen.